200.
What if a jet aircraft crashed every day in this country, and on board that jet, there were 200 people? 200 deaths every single day. And what if no one noticed? According to the Centers for Disease Control, approximately 200 people die every day from antibiotic-resistant superbug infections. Superbugs are just typical bacteria that don't respond to antibiotics anymore. Visualize that jet airplane is 200 superbugs, 200 infections, 200 deaths every single day. Sadly, these superbug infections are highly preventable. I mean, we all go to the hospital to get well, right? Well, that's no different than climbing aboard that aircraft and expecting to arrive at your destination safely. Unfortunately, antibiotic-resistant superbug infections have become the norm in healthcare. And in many senses, it's become the norm in our community settings as well. Perhaps you've heard of some of these infections, some of these superbugs. For example, extremely resistant tuberculosis kills tens of thousands of people every single year. Or maybe you've heard of Clostridium difficile, sometimes called C. diff. C. diff is a notorious pathogen, a notorious superbug, in hospital settings, but also in nursing homes and elder care. Maybe you've even heard of CRE, which has recently been ripped from the headlines and was on a popular episode of Chicago Med. As an infectious disease specialist in microbiology, I've been working with one called methicillin-resistant Staphylococcus aureus for about a decade now. Some of you have heard of this as MRSA, and many of you may have even experienced this either yourself or maybe a family member or a friend as a staph infection. There's many reasons for antibiotic resistance that many people don't realize. You've probably heard of the global reasons. Sometimes the animal industry gets blamed for putting antibiotics in their feed, primarily just to kind of help their animals be more productive and healthy. But you probably can relate more to the local reasons. Not global, but local. Things like, have you ever stopped taking your antibiotics when you felt better, even though you should have taken them for maybe 2 weeks? Or maybe you borrowed some antibiotics from a friend or a family and kind of just self-diagnosed without a lab test to prove that. Maybe you had an allergy or a cold virus. When we do these things, whether they're global or local, they are all contributing factors to antibiotic resistance. You see, what we're doing is we're basically placing these typical bacteria in a sort of environmental pressure cooker. They have no choice but to mutate and become resistant to commonly known antibiotics. We're basically creating a scenario of survival of the fittest. And believe me, superbugs are the fittest of survivors. Antibiotic resistance has devastating impacts on society. Dr. Margaret Chan from the World Health Organization and other experts, including myself, believe that by the year 2050, there will be a financial and economic impact from these organisms of up to $100 trillion. And by the same year, 2050, the impact could be 10 million deaths. 10 million deaths. Ladies and gentlemen, that's one new infection every 3 seconds. There just went one. If these numbers continue, superbug infections will kill more than cancer by that year. They already kill more than HIV and H1N1 flu combined. Something to think about. When I talk about these organisms with my friends and family, our students as they're learning about these things, I often tell them, you know, these bugs, these bacteria that have become superbugs, they're not your grandparents' bugs anymore. They're not even your parents. You see, these bugs don't read the books. They don't follow the rules. They resist, they mutate, and they ultimately kill. Dr. Chan and myself believe that we are entering an era of modern medicine that we will not recognize. One in which routine operations and a simple scraped knee would be fatal. Two everyday professionals that save lives. Two everyday heroes that show up every day and save lives. But we have a dilemma. It's really a need to increase awareness about these two everyday heroes, these two everyday professionals. These two professionals are misunderstood. They're lacking in identification and understanding. And sadly, many times, just sometimes a lack of respect. You see, hygiene specialists and medical laboratory professionals are behind the scenes. They're sort of like the ground crew in the airline industry. People you don't see every day. You see the pilot, the doctor. You see the nurse, maybe the flight attendant. Maybe you see the ticket taker. But you don't see the mechanics and the ground crew. But I bet you want them at work. Imagine a time when you were in high school, or maybe even junior high, and you and maybe one of your friends, or maybe one of your enemies, right? And you knew that they were outstanding in math and science. Or maybe they just hung out in the lab all day, every day, and drove their teachers crazy. Maybe they just like to solve problems. And when they came to that teacher or that advisor, or maybe a counselor, or maybe even a family member or a parent, and they wanted some information, some advice about what they should major in college, or maybe even a professional career path. And they said to them, you know what, Rodney? Why don't you be an engineer? Why don't you go to pharmacy school? Maybe major in biochemistry. Maybe even go to medical school. But I would bet you that they did not hear, and I certainly didn't hear, about these two professions. Why don't you become a hygiene specialist or a medical laboratory professional? You see, there's a dual problem with these two careers. There's the upstream problem that we just talked about, the non-recognition when you're in school at the lower grades. And then there's even the problem when I become a professional in these areas. You don't see me, right? You don't see me in the laboratory doing those tests. You see that pilot, that doctor, and there is nothing wrong with those noble professions. But sometimes you need to see behind the scenes as well. Meet Callie Cannon. On the right there. She's a medical laboratory professional. She's also a proud alumni from Texas State University's Clinical Laboratory Science Program. Callie and those like her, including myself, provide critical medical diagnostic testing for antibiotic-resistant superbug infections. You want her on that bench. You need her on that bench or people die. You see, medical laboratory professionals provide up to 75% of the data that physicians use and other healthcare members use to positively, correctly identify what's going on with you and then pick the correct antibiotic for you. They spend thousands of hours in medical, educational, and clinical settings learning these tests. Not your doctor or nurse, the medical laboratory professional. They actually major in four areas. They have to learn clinical microbiology, clinical hematology, which is the study of red and white blood cells, clinical chemistry, and then a big word, immunohematology, which is basically blood banking. And then on top of all that, they have to superimpose that with quality control and statistical analysis and algorithms so that they can pick the right test for the right symptoms and history that your physician has noticed. Karen Kite on the left, she's a hygiene specialist with the environmental services team at Regional Medical Clinic in Orangeburg, South Carolina. Karen is a hygiene specialist and those like her. They are the secret weapon against antibiotic-resistant superbugs. They use multimodal solutions and strategies to predict the correct sterilant or disinfectant to clean the proper surface in that healthcare environment. You see, they're educated and trained in these decision-making skills. They may have to pick UV irradiation to clean a room, or they may choose some other automatic robotic processing to clean that room. They're even responsible for the everyday hand hygiene that kills up to 75% of people just because we don't wash our hands. So they do all that, and they do it over all areas of the hospital. Very critical. Imagine a time when you went into a hospital to visit a loved one, or maybe you just visited your doctor's office, or perhaps you just went to the rec center in your community, and you walked in and you, lemony fresh. And look how organized this place is. They've got it together here. This place is safe. I feel good about my loved one in this room. But you see, Karen is a hygiene specialist, and myself as an infectious disease microbiologist, we know clean does not necessarily mean microbially clean, and it certainly doesn't mean sterile. You need hygiene specialists making those decisions. It's not like going home, spraying some Lysol around, and wiping up the kitchen counter. Those are good practices, by the way, but it's not the same as performing an operation in the hospital room or just doing routine procedures. These two professions are critical in this sense behind the scenes of healthcare. Sadly, these two professions are dwindling in numbers. They're dwindling numbers not just because of retirements, which has happened to many industries, but in a sense they're dwindling because simply we don't know about them. And so that's one of the things I'm going to ask you to do when you leave here today, is to share some of this, because it's critical. It's critical that we get these words out about these two professions. You see, my mission and passion is to overcome this obstacle, these dwindling numbers with these professions. Through communication, through awareness, and through education, you can help us to prevent that superbug infection, that jet crash. You can do this by spreading these awareness of this type of career. How can you help us even more? What is our call to action? If you increase the awareness of these heroes, these professions, you can help us to continue to prevent these types of infections. You can help us to provide more numbers in the community settings and in the healthcare settings. Please, share these publications that I and my colleagues have published about the secret weapon against these types of infections, the hygiene specialist. Spread the word about these two hidden professions so that we might increase that knowledge. Share this TEDx talk. Share these stories I've shared with you today. Become a mentor. Perhaps your son or daughter is thinking about a career right now or a major. Talk to them. Do they really want to be in the front line of healthcare? It's important to know. Do they want to be a doctor? Do they want to be a nurse? Noble professions. But maybe they don't. But they love science. And they love helping people. And they love saving lives. If nothing else, share this hashtag. Because these two professions, you see, we save lives every day. Even when you don't know it. Even when you don't understand it. Right? So these are the people behind the scenes. If you do this, you can help us to prevent that jet crash, which means fewer superbug infections, fewer deaths. By doing this, by communicating and educating others, you can help us solve this crisis. 200 deaths every single day. We need these professions. What if, instead of 200 casualties, there were only 100? Or 50 casualties?